In this chapter, I want to show you a new way of selecting and detecting your feature points and setting your markers. And for that, of course, I go to the movie clip editor, click on open, then go to my footage folder, into camera tracking, then Sophia, and then load this clip. Open clip, Alt A, and then wait until it has reached the final point, which is, I believe, at frame 200 or so. So there we go. Here, let's say 200 is our last frame. So here, press E for end frame. And then go full screen and playback. So that is a shot that I've been filming in Sofia in Bulgaria during last year's TOSMI, training in open source multimedia instruments, which has been very nice Blender course in Sofia. So we've been filming here at this place in Sofia, and we've been filming this with a crane. That is why this is a rather smooth shot. So now we have a lot of features that we can track in this frame. You know, all these points are ideal markers that you can track and it should be really nice. But instead of now picking these by hand, I want to do that automatically. And for that, first I want to go to tracking settings and make sure that I'm using the default setting. Then we can collapse that again. And now instead of picking these by hand, I can just click on detect features. And that will pick the features based on certain parameters. And these parameters you can find down here in the last operator menu. Or you can also press F6 to bring up that menu. And that is three main parameters. For example, the margin. And if you increase the margin, then you can tell Blender to only track features that are a certain distance away from the border of the frame. So if that is really large, then you can see this is much further away from the border. Or you can also increase the trackability, which is probably something like better contrast or other parameters that Blender thinks it can track better. So in some cases that can give you better results. Or you can also increase the distance. So if markers have to be, 300 pixels away from each other, then of course we have much less markers. But let's set it back to the defaults with the reset button and then try that. By the way, don't worry about that black line down here. That is something very typical for Canon DSLRs, especially the Canon 5D, which is the camera with that we have been filming this shot. So Canon DSLR cameras are actually recording 8 pixels more than normally. So instead of just HD, 1920 by 1080, we now have 1920 by 1088. Now the Canon 5D just adds 8 black pixels, whereas the Canon 550D actually is recording 8 additional pixels. But if you open up this Canon footage in a video player, VLC or QuickTime or whatever, then you will just see the normal 1920 by 1080 because that is the information that is in the header of the movie file, so the player knows what ratio or what pixels it has to display. But actually in the signal there are 8 additional, in this case, black pixels. But anyway, don't worry about that too much. We will just try to track that as best as we can, or as best as Blender can. So let's just press that button on frame 1 and track forward. And of course, here on the last frame, we have almost no active tracks anymore, simply because all these tracks are leaving the frame. So for that, on the last frame, I want to press detect features again so that we have new features that we can track backwards after that. But before, let's press Ctrl L so that we don't accidentally track these markers again, because we have already tracked and finished them. So Ctrl L to lock them. Now they are all grayed out and we can press detect features again and then track in the opposite direction. All right, now unlock everything so that everything is like editable. And now let's have a closer look if all these markers are doing the correct thing. Because here you can already see that there is quite some jumping happening. And maybe we can see that better if we turn off the footage for a moment. And you can do that by using this checkbox here, mute footage, or use the shortcut M. So that will mute the footage. It is still there, but it's just not being shown. And now to see that better, maybe we can also disable all these disabled tracks, just not display them. And to do that, we go to the display panel and then uncheck this box, or again use the hotkey Alt D to enable or disable the disabled tracks. So now Alt A to playback. And now it's much more obvious that we have really a lot of jumping here. So of course we have to clean that up. Maybe let's first have a look at why these are jumping. So let me pick this one, for example. Maybe also enable the footage again. And surprise, it's an edge. These kind of features are really hard to track. It's almost impossible to really get a decent track from that. Maybe here it could have been tracking because there you have that marker. But then again, this is on the background. So when the footage is moving, or the camera is moving, of course, then the relation between this dark area here and that bright area here would change, because change of perspective. So that point in the distance on the background would probably move up and down. So that marker, if you would set it here, then it would slide up and down. So that is really a bad track and we cannot use it. So just go ahead and delete it. Okay, now we can go through all of these jumping markers, but of course that is a little bit tedious. And that's why we are going to use the curve view for that. So just enable that with this button or press Z. Now we can much better see where you have all these jumps. Of course, to see all these markers, let's select everything with A. And now you can see all these spikes. So we do have this general direction, that curve here, but some of these markers are really jumping away. And therefore you have that spike. And we can just select everything that has these spikes and just delete it. So delete that, 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 especially the curves that have a lot of spikes, like these ones, they are really bad and we cannot use them. Some of them will just have a spike for some frames. Maybe I can show you that here on this one. Okay, so that one, you can see that is highlighted here. It's a little bit darker. It seems to be okay, even though, where is it? Here. Okay, even though the feature that it is tracking is not necessarily very good, because it is tracking some diffuse spot here. But nevertheless, if you select that, okay, it is sliding like crazy, so that is totally unusable. But no, okay, we have to delete that. Okay, no, that was a bad example. So just go ahead and delete that. And maybe I can show you some other marker. Okay, that one is also pretty bad because it is also a fuzzy feature and we have that jump. So that one too. Okay, I will just go on and delete all these spikes. Ah, no, that is a good example. Okay, so we have that, which is a rather nice curve, even though it is also sliding, but the curve is okay. So it is not so bad, but on the last frame, we have this huge spike. And if you center the view to that, you can see something very characteristic. And that is that on the last frame here, when the feature hits the border, it then starts to slide down. Because otherwise, if it would just move as it would normally, it would be on that frame here, which is really close to the border. And for some reason, that is very typical, that these markers are then not being disabled, which they should, but on the last frame, they just jump up or down, like so. And that is why here in the curve view, you have that very characteristic shape of this curve, so that is rather smooth, but just on the last frame, you have this spike going down. And the spike happens because the curves are the acceleration along the X and Y axis. And because we have that sudden movement, there's a huge acceleration compared to the previous frame. So that is why you get that shape. And in this case, if the marker would not be sliding like it does, then we could just delete or disable the marker for this one single frame. So here on that frame, where it has jumped away, we can just press Shift D to disable that, and it has been cut off. Now the problem is that currently we had everything selected, so every marker that has been selected will be disabled, and that is of course not what we want. So Control Z to undo that, and then instead just select this one. So first deselect everything with A, and then just select this one, press Shift D to select to disable that, and then you have just disabled that one. I'm pretty sure that very soon we will be able to disable just one marker if you have the mouse up here, even though everything down there is selected. One thing that you can do already is to delete single markers without having to deselect everything else. So when you select a marker that is now active here, so it is white, the other ones are selected, so they are yellow, and up here you have that highlighted curve. And when you have the mouse in this area and press X, then you will just delete that one single marker. But if you have the mouse down here and want to delete that, then you will delete everything. So it is kind of context sensitive in which area the mouse is, so everything that you do up here in terms of deleting will only be happening for the selected curve. And I'm pretty sure that very soon we will be able to also do stuff like that, not just for deleting but also disabling, so that when you have something selected here and all of these selected and you have the mouse up here and press Shift D, then you will be able to only disable that one particular marker for that frame but not everything. The same will probably and hopefully happen for clear after and clear before, because for example, okay, let's take this one. So you have that, I mean it's very short, but anyway. So you have that marker and it seems to track some frames okay. Here for example, you could say that is not all too bad. So why should we delete everything? Why not just delete the problematic stuff? So all of these frames. So in that case you can select that here, and then when only this marker is selected, you can here click on Clear After or Alt T. And that will clear or delete and disable everything that is behind that frame. Or if you hit Shift T, then it will clear everything that is before that frame. So in that case, since that is not so very bad here on these frames, even though it is sliding a little bit, but now we can press Clear After or Alt T to clear everything here. And well, now we have that problematic spikes are, now these are gone. But if you have everything selected and press Alt T, then you will not be able to do that here. But if you have the mouse in this area and press Alt T, then everything will be deleted. So probably and hopefully we will be able to do that up here in the curve view as well. Okay, but for now I have to just clean up all this stuff, all these spikes, until we have only these smooth curves. Now you might think that these are problematic as well, but in fact they are not. And the thing is that all these markers that have these spikes on the red curve are markers that I have added here on the last frame and we have tracked backwards. So the markers are tracking, just select that one. So the markers started tracking here. We have a little error here, but don't worry about that. So they are tracking and then they hit the border of the frame and they are being disabled. And every track that has the starting point in the middle of the shot will have this very characteristic curve, because we have that acceleration, or actually on this frame there is no acceleration, and on the next frame then the movement starts, so there is some acceleration data, and that is why you have that curve. Okay, but now let's clean up all the rest of these spiky things, or actually that one is something that we can also just Alt T, clear after, like so. Okay, but now I'll just delete all these, go away. Okay, now Alt D to disable or to display the disabled tracks again, and then A and A again, so that we have everything selected, because there are still some spikes left. So all these have to be deleted. And as you can see, that is pretty tedious, I have to say. This is really not easy. And in the end, it would be even faster to just select the feature points by hand and track them and be really sure that they are the correct features and that they are tracking correct, instead of doing all this crappy cleanup work here. All right, but now that we've got that, we should have a look at here at these frames, because Alt D again, there is not much markers, although maybe it's not too bad. We could do something and again select everything, hit Control L, detect features again, maybe with a bigger distance so that there are not that much markers, maybe like so, and then track them forward, and after that track them backward so that we have some more markers here in the center of the shot. All right, and now of course delete the spikes again. And pardon my voice, I have a little cold and cough, so I'm probably not the best voice today to record tutorials, but anyway, I have to finish this, so I hope it's not too annoying. All right, Alt L, A. So that looks okay. So with that, we can start solving that, finally. So the camera has been a Canon 5D. So Canon 5D. I also know that the focal length probably, I believe it was something 28 or 35 millimeters or so. So maybe let's start with a 30. Sensor is 36, and there is some lens distortion, but since we don't know, let's just try like so. Okay, click on camera motion to solve that. And this will now take a little bit longer, since we have now really a lot of tracks that have to be calculated. Okay, but 17 is really not acceptable. So there is something going on and we have to investigate that. And my guess is that there is sliding happening. So I'm going to have to just try and see if we can find the problematic tracks. So maybe Alt A and have a very close look at all these markers and what they are doing. If there is something sliding. Currently can't see any bad sliding here. Maybe that is, oh yeah, look at that. Very typical problem. All right, okay, you can see that. Again, we have the same problem. Here is some contrast and here is some contrast. But since this is in the background and that is in the foreground, there is some shifting in the perspective. Really, really bad. So we have to delete that. Maybe that helps already. So Shift S to solve that. No, still very bad. Okay, there is a good candidate for a problem as well. So here the woman is moving and the marker is on the woman here. So of course the marker is moving as well. And markers, as you know, have to be fixed in space. So X, delete track. Now let's see what have we got else. So here there are some markers that are just very short. So this is just tracking for 12 frames. And this is something that we cannot really use. It's not enough perspective information inside of these 12 frames. So we can just delete everything that is tracking for just 12 frames. But again, selecting them by hand would be very tedious, so let's do that automatically. So here in the tool shelf, go to cleanup and first make sure that everything is deselected. Also make sure that nothing that is disabled is selected, so everything should be deselected. So with disabled tracks enabled, everything is now deselected. Okay, so now we can click on clean tracks. Nothing's happening, of course, because the threshold is currently at zero. So nothing will be taken into account. But if you now set the frames to 10 or 12 maybe and click on clean tracks, now you can see that there are some tracks selected. Maybe let's press Z to have a look at the curves. And there are all the markers that have been tracking for just 12 frames in that direction and also in that direction and in the center of the shot. And since they are so very short, we can also just delete them with X. Okay, clean tracks again. So nothing is selected now, but with the last operator menu here, we can slowly increase the number and maybe until 17 or 20 tracks. Maybe let's delete those. Okay, maybe see if that helps. Shift S. Oho, now look at that. Now this is 0.55, which is actually pretty good. So now that should be a decent track, but still not perfect. So here, nothing is selected currently. That's why you don't see the red and green curve. All you see is this blue curve. And the blue curve is the camera average solve error. So we know that there is a sudden error here in the camera movement. So probably if you now select everything again, there are probably some problematic tracks. So something's happening here and something is causing this spike in the blue curve of the camera. So maybe let's have a look at this one. That looks problematic. And indeed here you can see this is again sliding. So the last frames can be disabled. So Alt T just for that selected, of course. Now that error might be fixed. Then if you look at these curves, they are all doing that movement, but this one is going down. So is there a problem? No, there must be another reason. Okay, but since that sliding marker has been disabled, maybe that spike in the camera curve will be fixed after that. Now let's have a look here. There is some problem as well. Aha. You can see that also here in the path. That is a problem. So we have to fix that. Okay, now let's have a look. Yeah, so everything seems to be fine at first. But then there is one jump, goes to a different point and keeps on tracking that. So let's Alt T from here, like so. Okay, then here's another one. So what's happening here? Aha, again, some sliding. Now let me zoom in very closely. So we have here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, a few pixels. And the margin that you have here in the tracking settings is set to 0. That means that the marker will be disabled once the anchor point here in the center hits the frame, the border of the frame here. Then it will be disabled. But since the feature looks different from here to there, and since we have that sliding, maybe it might be good for the next time to set the margin to 20 pixels right away, like so. Because then, as soon as the marker is 20 pixels away from the border of the frame, it will be disabled. So eventually there will not be that jumping when a marker or a track leaves the border of the frame. Okay, but in this case, just select that, Alt T, and okay, let's try again, Shift S. Ah, now we are at 0.4, which is also very good. Still, there are some problems here. Well, I don't know. It's not too bad. So let's try to refine that with focal length and K1. Shift S. Although I think the refinement might not kick in. Let's have a look. No, it's still the same values. So in this case, we have to try to force Blender to refine that. That is also a limitation currently of Blender, that it doesn't always refine. It will need some well, some specific errors to trigger the refinement. I can't really explain that better, but in the future there will probably be a refinement way that will always kick in no matter what. But in this case we have to try to trigger that, and let me try by setting focal length to 20, because I think that is probably wrong. No, just the arrows going up. Okay, well, it seems it doesn't get better than this, so let's just use that. Now, to see if it all makes sense, we just can create the camera solution in 3D. So let's leave full screen and drag this down to create the 3D viewport, then hide the curves to see that better. Now switch here to 3D view, and now let's drag that down. And now we go ahead, go to clip, and then set up tracking scene like so. And that, well, that is a little bit weird in the room here. So let's just select a floor plane. And why not just use these? I mean, that is a great triangle and we can just use that. So tap to go into reconstruction mode. In the orientation panel, set floor. And we can also set this as the origin and that as maybe the x-axis. Or let's see. In top view, y-axis, yeah, I think like that. And also a scale. So that could be, I don't know, maybe that's 3 meters or so. So here distance is 3, set scale, and then 0 to look through the camera, edit mode, GZ1 to move it up. And now full screen and have a look at that. So that doesn't look too bad. Maybe in wireframe draw mode to see that better. Now at first it looks good, but then if you follow the lines, then that doesn't really fit. I mean, that should be a rectangular shape to the pool here. So we have these lines and that looks fine, but then as just assume that the pool here, that this thing, that this shape would sit like a rectangle here on the ground, so that these lines are also rectangular in relation to that pool. But if you have a look at the grid, then here that looks totally different than these lines here. But in that view, they pretty much follow the direction of the pool as well. Maybe we can select the camera and rotate around the z-axis just a little bit, so that these lines are following much more the direction of the pool. But still, over here, that is really different than the lines that we have in the footage. So there is somehow a mismatch between these grid lines that we see here and then the lines that are here in the footage. So even though at first glance it looks all right and not bad, well, if you would now insert geometry and some architectural elements, they would probably not really fit to the scene. And that is, of course, is a problem. Now, what you could do is to try to get a better solution. And now that we have the 3D space, we can make use of that to see if our solution makes sense, because obviously that one doesn't make much sense. So maybe let's first look from the top and make the 3D markers a little bit bigger. So here in the end panel, in motion tracking, I just increase the size like that. Okay. Now let's find out which of these markers should be straight lines and how they should be aligned in the space. So let me first select some of them over here. So these should be a one line like so. That is that line. And then we have these two, is it that one here? So that would be, in theory, at least I assume that, that in our scene it would be something like that. So here is the pool, and then we have these lines in the footage, these ones here. But obviously, in fact, it looks different. So what we have is something like this, and that is not correct. So we have to fix that, and to do that I will just play around with my camera data, because that obviously is the most important thing that we can change in order to try to get a better solution. All right, so we have this solution now with 30 millimeters focal length. Now let's see what happens when we set this to 20. I mean, it will be totally wrong, of course, but let's just see how that looks like in the 3D solution. So Shift S to solve with 20 millimeters. So okay, it is totally wrong, so we cannot even use that at all. But if you have a look here, then you can see we have still selected these markers. So that would be that line of the pool, but these are now really, really a wide angle. And of course it is, because 20 millimeters would be a wide angle lens. So camera is here. So that is now what happens. And we want to have the opposite effect. We want to, instead of having a wider angle, we want to make the angle between these lines. I hope you can still follow what lines I'm drawing here. So we want to have that angle. Again, I'm talking of the angle here. That should be a 90 degree angle. And in fact, here it's not. So what we want to have instead is that, a 90 degree angle. And since going lower with the focal length had the opposite result, maybe if we go a little bit higher, maybe that can help. So let me try 34 and solve that and see what happens. Oops, now the solve error is so big that we cannot really use that at all. So 34 millimeters has some problems. Maybe if we assume that there is some lens distortion, maybe that can help. So let's set this to 0.05, and I'm using a positive value here because I just know that this lens has a distortion that goes in the opposite direction than we had in the previous shot. And as you can see, just this little value here, the K1 distortion value, gave us a solution that is much better. Now we are again at 0.4. Okay, let's see what we've got. So, camera, rotate, looks like that improved the whole thing. So we have this line again, and here these two markers now form 90 degree angle. So it seems that this is now better. So that solution makes sense. And if you look at that, these lines are now, oh, look at that, that is great. In fact, now it's really quite good because the grid lines go in this direction. And if you go back, then here, ta-da, 90 degree angle. So the grid fits as well. So now that is a solution that might be something to work with. So just by looking at the 3D points and trying to figure out what the lens might have looked like, we have been able to get a better solution. Well, one reason for that was also that I just knew what the K1 value might have been, because I know this lens and I know that it has that kind of distortion. So that was one point why we have been able to achieve that. But still, the fact remains that you can just look at the solution and look at how the 3D markers should look like, and therefore figure out what the lens might have been or what the solution should be. All right, but you see, it was a lot of work to clean up all the tracks and to try to get a good solution. So it might have been easier to pick the correct features in the first place. So instead of using the detect features feature, just pick the features for yourself, try to get the right features, and maybe that will save you some time that you don't have to do cleaning up, jumping markers. So maybe I can just demonstrate that. So very quickly, I delete everything and then start right away from scratch. So first of all, I want to have some markers here on that shape, just to have the reference for this straight line. So here, just pick these ones, collapse that, track, make it bigger. So that one, that one, here, and here. So that should be enough for that straight line. Then also something here on the floor, just to have some perspective information in the foreground. Also here, that corner might be something to track. Then that point. So just a few here in the foreground. Okay, so before I track that, I'll just add some more. Here, that white corner should be very easy to track. Also that one should be pretty good. Then maybe there and here, and you see I'm just picking some high contrast points where there's no edges or a corner. Corner is also always good. Something up here, maybe here. Okay, that should be enough for now. Let's track that. So select that, Control T, and let's see, let's have a look at the curves. Yeah, that looks quite good. There might be a little problem. No, still fine. But here, that one is starting to slide for a few frames. So again, here I will just turn it off. Alt T. And looks fine. So Control L to lock them. And great. Okay, so let's continue. So we've got that area here covered. We have something here. We can track a few more. That one. Then here there is a great point. Then also we should cover something in the background. You should always try to cover as much space as you can. So always track something in the foreground, track something in the background, and try to distribute it evenly throughout the space. Okay, then I'm not tracking anything of these leaves because there might be wind. These leaves might move, or the trees might swing in the wind slowly. So in that case, you would have sort of moving or sliding markers, so to say. And to avoid that, just don't track anything that moves. And well, leaves and trees can move by wind. So maybe we should avoid tracking that. All right, I think that's enough. So let's track them. And since the other ones are locked, I can just press A to select everything, hit Control T, and the locked markers will not be tracked accidentally. So let's lock them as well, Control L. And now, at this point, I also want to track something here in the very near foreground. So that would be something to track. Also that corner, maybe first backwards to that place, and then from there, Control T with L. Yeah, then Control if everything went fine, and seems it did. Then something to really avoid would be that. I mean, it looks like a great corner and it would be very easy to track. But if you do that, then you will just produce problems, because that is not a fixed point. That is just the crossing section of these elements. And in fact, when you look at the place where that marker here is moving, it is just both going on that edge, like from here to there. And also here on this curved line, it also goes on that line up and down just a little bit. It's not that bad, but if you track backwards, yeah, see, it slides. So that is the same problem that we had earlier here. That point would be also something to avoid tracking, because it will track great because there's enough contrast, but it will just slide. So these are places that you really should avoid. But then again, we do need some more information in the foreground. So let's see if we have some more. Maybe there's enough contrast. I don't know. Let's see. Control T with L. Yeah, looks good. Opposite direction looks also fine. So that's great. Then that corner might be something to track. Okay, there it has a problem, so just scale it up and then go frame by frame like that. Okay. Automatic tracking fails. So frame by frame in this case might save that track, or just scaling up the whole thing with S, or enable the search area with Alt S. Yeah, see, you have to increase that. So increase the size as well, and then like so. Then also here, I think that will also help, because if you avoid these, because it has a lot of difference in relation to that. So they are shifting, so to say. So Shift T in that case to clear everything before that, like so. Then also this one, and I'm doing all this foreground elements because, well, I think I repeat myself. Yeah, okay. Then also something here in the very near foreground. And because these features are so near to the camera, they are also not so sharp. So in that case, it can really help to just make them bigger. Yeah, maybe that's enough. Then here, and I think I should not bore you with all these tracks. So I will now just continue tracking, but then speed it up in the final recording so that you can just follow which tracks I'm adding. And maybe that can give you some hints what positions might be good to track. Okay, so we'll just continue, and you can follow that in time-lapsed version. All right, so I have just finished tracking the shot and we've got some markers here in the very near foreground, then something here in the midground, also in the background, of course, so everything should be covered pretty nicely. So now let's see if we can get a decent solution from that. So first of all, here in the camera data, maybe let's set this back to the default, or not the default, but the values that we had before. So that would be 30 and 0 for the K1 value. Like that. And then also you notice that I have different keyframes than before, or the default keyframes are 1 and 30, but a few minutes ago I just set them to 105 and 221 to test something, which didn't work out in the end, but anyway, I want to, let's just see if what happens if we use 1 and 30. So that would be the default, and also let's set this to nothing so that no refinement will happen. Then Shift S. Okay, 0.5, that is not too bad. All right, so now let's see if we can trigger the automatic refinement. So set this to focal length and K1. And nothing happened. Okay, well, let's have a look at these keyframes. So it is frame 1, that is here, and 30. So on these two frames, Blender will start calculating the solution. But when you look at the markers here, then there is not that much movement. I mean, of course, it goes from left to right. But maybe let's turn off the footage. So when you look at that, maybe without the path, then at least I wouldn't be able to immediately tell the perspective on these frames. You can somehow guess that these are probably more in the foreground, but other than that, it is not so very clear. Whereas if you go to here, between 70 and 110, that is something completely different. So that is now totally clear that this is here in the foreground, and it's just by looking at that, you can really see the perspective and the scene. So maybe if we set the keyframes to that, maybe that can trigger that refinement. Just in case, who knows? Let's see. So keyframe A could be here, 70. And then maybe here, 110. So let's see, Shift S. Ah, now I can see refinement is happening. And indeed, now we are at 0.45 and we've got an estimated focal length. And also now we are at 35 and 0.06. So with our initial guess a few minutes ago with 35 and 0.05, we were actually pretty close. So that's cool. That should be a great solution. And also here there are no sudden spikes. I mean, there are some errors, but that's not too bad. And it's not a sudden spike, so it should be fine. And now we can go ahead and create the 3D scene by clicking the Setup Tracking Scene button and then also assigning the floor. So here, that looks already quite good. Hide that and then select this point, that and that, just like before. Then go to Reconstruction. Set floor, then here set origin, and then maybe this could be the y-axis, maybe the other way around. So click again, and now that looks totally great. So let's have a look through the camera by pressing 0, and that makes totally sense. Maybe we can make the markers a little bit smaller just by dragging this down. So as you can see, the grid lines are actually in line with the lines in our scene. And also here we have a nice rectangular shape. All right, but we've got quite a bunch of markers here. And it can be kind of confusing to see which marker is on what place. And so when you look from above, I mean, when you look through the camera, it's of course totally clear where is what. But if you look from above, then you might want to be able to orient yourself better. And for that, you can make use of custom colors. So for example, if I pick all these points here that are more or less on one line, then here, now we can really see which marker is what, because it is now selected. But as soon as they are deselected, I cannot tell which marker is where and so on. So for that, it would be cool to have a custom color. And these custom colors you can assign here in the track panel. So if you go here to that menu, you can pick from a bunch of presets. So I guess that the default values are default, far plane, and object maybe. I'm not sure if these are actually also in the normal preset folder. Anyway, when you activate one of these presets, for example, far plane, then the marker will now turn blue as soon as it is deselected. So it is blue, or instead of using the preset, you can of course also just go ahead and activate that button here, custom color, and then assign any color you like, for example, a nice pink, like so. Now we've got that pink marker. And to assign this color to a bunch of markers, you have to first select them, like, for example, these ones. And then also let me use these. And now then pick the marker with that color that you want to use. Hit spacebar and then just type copy color, or just copy. And then you can choose that, press enter. And now these are all pink. And as soon as they are deselected, then you can also see here that even the 3D markers in your 3D viewport are now also pink. So now it is much easier to see that these should be on that line. So when we rotate that, okay, like so. And these are now on one line. That is also still pretty nice angle here, rectangular shape. And we can now assign different colors for different objects. For example, everything that is on the floor can be one color. Everything that is near can be one color. Objects could be a color, and so on. So again, these could get a different color, like, I don't know, green. So copy color. And now we've got these green markers on the benches. So that way it will be much easier to orient yourself in the scene when you are not currently looking through the camera. And that is, of course, also one advantage of supervised tracking, so manually picking the markers, as opposed to feature detection, because you really can just pick the features that you want to use, also that you want to mark in your 3D scene. So by picking them yourself, you can much easier really just pick the ones that you need and then also assign the color right away. And it will be much easier to see what's going on in the 3D scene.